You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Indian security forces continue elimination of Pakistan-backed terrorists. India slams Pakistan at UNSC, calls Jammu and Kashmir inalienable part of country. And expansion of Islamic State in Afghanistan poses challenge for Taliban. Let's begin the show with India's Jammu and Kashmir, where peace remains disrupted due to consistent Pakistan-aided terror activities. However, India remains committed to fighting all its tricks to stop its Western neighbor from inciting terror in the valley. Indian security forces have been successful in busting all the nefarious anti-India plots hatched in the corridors of Islamabad and Rawalpindi. We have this report.
Islamabad's executive wing, specializing in terrorism, received a huge setback as Indian security forces eliminated top terrorist and Hizbul Mujahideen's district commander, Shakir Nazar, who was active since 2018, along with two other terrorists. The twin encounters had broken out in South Kashmir's Kulgam district. Another terrorist killed in the encounter was identified as Afaq Sikandar, a commander of the Resistance Front, an offshoot of the Lashkar-e-Taiba terror group. Earlier, a Pakistani terrorist and his associate were eliminated in an encounter in the Haidarpura area of Jammu and Kashmir's Srinagar. Peace and development in India's Jammu and Kashmir does not suit Pakistan. Despite international condemnation, Islamabad continues to send its proxies to infiltrate into the Kashmir Valley and create fear psychosis among the people. However, to its major disappointment, Indian security forces are well aware of Pakistan's nefarious propaganda and eliminating the terrorists entering from across the border.
In the day, SP Kulgaon got the news that in Gopalpura, Pome, there are two villages where terrorists are hidden. So, the army, CRP, police, and the cordon were placed. Cordon was placed because of the search started. So, the terrorists fired from the inside. फिर इनकाउंटर में तब्दील हो गया और दोनों दोनों इनकाउंटर स्टार्ट हो गया है। गोपालपुरा में इनकाउंटर ख़त्म हो गया, वहाँ दो टूरिस्ट मारे गए हैं, दोनों टीआरएफ का है, उसमें एक है पहचान हुआ है सिकंदर लोन जो कि डिस्ट्रिक्ट कमांडर टीआरएफ का है, और पोमे में इनकाउंटर चल रहा है जिसमें दो टूरिस्ट मारे गए, एक इनकाउंटर में टूरिस्ट अभी भी फायर फाइट में लगा है।
श्रीनगर सिटी हैज बीन विटनेसिंग फ्रीक्वेंट टेररिस्ट अटैक्स एंड इनकाउंटर्स फॉर द पास्ट फ्यू मंथ्स। It faced a spate of civilian killings in recent days. On November 7, a police constable named Tawseef Ahmed Wani and a salesman Ibrahim Khan were gunned down by armed terrorists. The security forces have identified a number of terrorist hideouts and overground workers who have been providing support to these terrorists to sneak into the Kashmir Valley. Meanwhile, the locals have condemned the terrorists and are coming out to support the Indian security forces for maintaining peace in the region.
आम जनता है उसका हमारे पर बहुत भरोसा है और बहुत कॉन्फिडेंस है। उनको मालूम है कि हम किस रास्ते से काम चलते हैं। हमें उसकी जरूरत ही नहीं है। I think we have achieved that level. White collar terrorists, सफेद पोश दहशतगर्द। हमें आवाम को उनसे आगाह करना है कि आप जाओ और उनसे दस्तक दो उनके घर के अंदर और उनसे बोलो कि तुम्हारे बच्चे को मेरे बच्चे को आप टेररिस्ट क्यों बना रहे हो, दहशतगर्द क्यों बना रहे हो, आप अपने बच्चे को पहले दहशतगर्द बनाओ और फिर मेरे बच्चे को बनाओ। जब तक ये नफरी कम नहीं हो जाएगी, जब तक हमारे लोग जागरूक होकर के उनसे ये सवाल नहीं पूछेंगे कि पूरी दुनिया आगे चलती जा रही है, पूरा देश आगे चलता जा रहा है, आप हमारे बच्चे को एक पुराने किस्म के माइंड सेट के अंदर लेके जा रहे हो, तब तक ये थोड़ी सी प्रॉब्लम रहेगी। बट मुझे मालूम है कि ज़मीन के ऊपर वो जो नफरी है, वो जो स्ट्रेंथ है ऐसे गलत लोगों की, वो धीरे-धीरे कम होती जा रही है।
पाकिस्तान हैज बीन रनिंग अ प्रॉक्सी वॉर इन कश्मीर फॉर ओवर 7 डेकेड्स एंड हैज बीन ट्राइंग टू कीप इट अलाइव बाय प्रमोटिंग टेररिज्म एंड मिसलीडिंग इनोसेंट कश्मीरीज। इट कॉन्स्टेंटली वायलेट्स द सीज फायर एट द लाइन ऑफ कंट्रोल to attain international attention. There are several camps in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir flourishing under the patronage of Pakistan Army and spy agencies, the ISI and military intelligence. Intelligence reports suggest the presence of 200 to 250 terrorists on the launch pad adjacent to the line of control. They are trying to infiltrate into the valley through new passages, as security forces have chalked the known routes of infiltration from POK. According to the sources, terror outfits like Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jaish-e-Mohammed and Al-Badr are under pressure to get maximum infiltration done before the onset of heavy snowfall in Kashmir.
India, which remains a victim of cross-border terrorism, has time and again raised the issue at international platforms. Recently, at the United Nations Security Council, India lambasted Pakistan for sponsoring terrorism as an instrument of state policy. The threat posed by Pakistan-sponsored terrorism has created uncertainty in South Asia. We have a report.
India has been a constant victim of Pakistan-backed terrorism. However, with its revived counter-terrorism strategies, New Delhi has not only managed to defeat this menace at home, but is also leading a collective fight against terrorism at international forums. At the recent session of United Nations Security Council, India extensively talked about the kind of impact that terrorism leaves on the country. Kajal Bhatt, legal advisor at India's permanent mission to the UN, condemned Pakistan's duplicity, identifying it as a key feature or obstacle in fighting the menace of terrorism originating from its soil. India also hit back at Pakistan after Islamabad raised the Kashmir issue at the UN Security Council.
I'm constrained to take the floor once again to respond to some frivolous remarks made by the representative of Pakistan earlier today. This is not the first time the representative of Pakistan has misused platforms provided by the UN to propagate false and malicious propaganda against my country, and seeking in vain to divert the world's attention from the sad state of his country, where terrorists enjoy free pass while the lives of ordinary people, especially those belonging to the minority communities, are turned upside down.
As a victim of cross-border terrorism for several decades, India has been at the forefront of the fight against terrorism. Slamming Islamabad for being a terror state, India also reiterated that Pakistan has an established history of actively supporting terror groups and holds the shameful record of hosting the largest number of terrorists proscribed by the UN Security Council.
Pakistan has an established history and policy of harboring, aiding and actively supporting terrorists. This is a country which has been globally recognized as one openly supporting, training, financing and arming terrorists as a matter of state policy. It holds the ignoble record of hosting the largest number of terrorists proscribed by the UN Security Council.
In 1947, Pakistan launched a tribal attack on Jammu and Kashmir and illegally occupied its large portion, thus categorically stating India's position. Ms. Bhatt said the entire Union territory of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh were, are and will always be an integral and inalienable part of India. New Delhi also called upon Islamabad to vacate the occupied territories.
We call upon Pakistan to immediately vacate all areas under its illegal occupation. India desires normal neighborly relations with all countries, including Pakistan, and is committed to addressing outstanding issues, if any, bilaterally and peacefully in accordance with the Shimla Agreement and the Lahore Declaration. However, any meaningful dialogue can be held only in an atmosphere free of terror, hostility and violence. The onus is on Pakistan to create such a conducive atmosphere. Till then, India will continue to take firm and decisive steps to respond to cross-border terrorism.
Pakistan, since decades, has been using all global platforms to spew venom against India. Its representatives pass fabricated and slanderous statements to further their anti-India propaganda. But eventually, to its much embarrassment, India puts the truth forward, hence exposing all of its lies and immoral terror connections.
The Taliban in Afghanistan is under intense international pressure to deny safe haven to terrorist groups, but its position towards handling these outfits remains indistinct. Emboldened by the Taliban's success, many terrorist groups like ISIS have gained success in re-establishing their presence in Afghanistan. They are carrying out frequent attacks in the war-affected nation that raises questions about the Taliban's capabilities to maintain peace and stability in the country. Take a look.
The Taliban has regained power in Afghanistan, but the people continue to suffer with terrorism. The Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, Khorasan branch, now poses a new security threat. It has claimed responsibility for twin explosions that shook Kabul city. The first blast in Dasht-e-Barchi area in a heavily Shiite Muslim area of western Kabul claimed lives of 9 civilians and injured 7. The second blast took place in the nearby Charahi Shahid area in which 5 persons were killed. The explosions came after at least 3 people were killed and 15 wounded by a bomb at a mosque in Nangarhar. Meanwhile, the Taliban fighters were busy showing off demonstrations of weapons that fell into their hands after the withdrawal of the US-led NATO forces. Not only did they showcase their power, but also applauded their government for establishing so-called peace and security in the nation amid frequent terror attacks by ISIS.
افغانستان کې 50 ملکونه وو، امریکا و ناټو و لوی قدرتونه وو، د ډالرو باران و، بیا یې هم امن نه سوای راوستی، بیا یې هم نظام نه سوای کنټرولولی، بیا یې هم د قدرت جزیرې نه سوای له منځه وړلی. نن چې موږ هغه کارونه ټول کړي دي او ټولې دنیا ته مې اطمینان هم ورکړی، زه نه پوهېږم چې اوس دوی نور څه مشکل لري چې له موږ نه یې غواړي.
The rapid expansion of Islamic State in Afghanistan worries the international community. The United Nations envoy to Afghanistan said that the regional affiliate of the Islamic State group now appears present in nearby all Afghan provinces and increasingly active. The Taliban's genuine efforts to present itself as a government are partly constrained by the lack of resources and capacity, as well as a political ideology that clashes with contemporary international norms of governance.
Another major negative development has been the Taliban's inability to stem the expansion of the Islamic State in Iraq and the Levant Khorasan province. Once limited to a few provinces and Kabul, ISILKP now seems to be present in nearly all provinces and increasingly active. The number of attacks has increased significantly from last year to this year. In 2021, 60. So far this year, 334 attacks attributed to ISKP or in fact claimed by ISKP. ISKP continues to target the Shiite communities. The Taliban insists that they are waging a concerted campaign against ISILKP, but this campaign is worrying in that it appears to rely heavily on extrajudicial detentions and killings of suspected ISILKP members. This is an area deserving of more attention from the international community.
Islamic State has viewed the Taliban as its strategic rival. It considers the Taliban as filthy nationalists who have betrayed the greater Islamic cause. They see the Taliban as just another kind of political outfit cutting deals with the Americans that are ideologically not pure, as per ISIS. The brutal jihadi group's fight against the Taliban is entering a new phase, and analysts believe that in the coming days, this rivalry will take more violent form.
Let's move to Pakistan's Balochistan province, which generally remains hidden from the eyes of the world, has been suffering from a serious humanitarian crisis for over 7 decades. Ethnic communities living in the region have been facing arbitrary detentions and forced disappearances and killings by the state and non-state actors. Over the years, the people residing in these territories are being murdered by Pakistani security forces and terrorists to suppress their voices of freedom. Most of these cases go unnoticed since the cold-blooded Pakistan government does not allow any media or rights organization to visit and investigate the actual situation. We take a look.
Over the years, Pakistan-backed terrorism has risen sharply in Balochistan region. The Baloch nation has been struggling for their freedom since the occupation of Balochistan by Pakistan in 1948. As part of its counter-liberation strategy, Pakistani forces have been violating human rights and committing war crimes in the region that has led to the killing of thousands of Baloch civilians and activists. The people of Balochistan, a large number of whom have migrated to Europe, have been telling the international community about their sufferings, but the world remains silent. To pay tribute and respect to every Baloch who sacrificed their life for independence and defense of their motherland, Baloch Martyrs Day is observed every year on 13th November. This year too, several Baloch activists and intellectuals living in Germany's Hanover city commemorated the Baloch Martyrs Day alike every year. During a seminar organized by Baloch National Movement to remember Baloch martyrs, several human rights activists were also present along with Baloch leaders.
I believe, I live with that belief that the day will come when together we will celebrate, we will jubilate our freedom and our right, our lands, and we all have to work for it. It is a cause worth for that, and it is a cause, it is the way to pay real tribute to our fallen heroes. Long live Balochistan, long live Sindh.
In Balochistan, human rights violations have become the norm. The Pakistani state and its security agencies have habitually trampled upon the human rights of Baloch people in the name of security and regional integrity. These atrocities are not just limited to Baloch people, but Pakistani army has systematically carried out mayhem on the Sindhis, the Pashtuns and even Muhajirs, who have been facing persecution and other brutalities in the hands of Pakistani security forces, terrorist groups and criminal gangs. A large part of their young population has been the victim of enforced disappearances and extrajudicial killings. Voices of freedom raised by human rights activists are silenced with the power of guns by the Pakistani army and establishment. They are often charged with treason, branded as terrorists and killed in encounters or picked up by security forces.
These kids, these women and these men, because they were Balochistan, they were slaughtered. Because they embodied a vision of freedom, they were slaughtered. Because they wanted to protect the honor of our motherland, stained shamelessly and ruthlessly by Pakistan, they were slaughtered. In this very deep and painful day of commemoration, where all the Baloch and its diaspora and supporters of this cause are united, I address on my name a compassion and solicitude to the families of the fallen ones.
Balochistan has the most mineral deposits among the provinces of Pakistan. The Baloch stare at a bleak future, looking on helplessly as the Chinese take control of their mineral-rich land under the pretext of China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, fortifying and fencing areas like the port city of Gwadar. China is not only violating human rights in its own occupied territories, but has collaborated with Pakistan to exploit natural resources in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, Gilgit-Baltistan and Balochistan. Therefore, common Baloch and Baloch leaders have been protesting in Pakistan's port city Gwadar against China's multi-billion dollar belt and road projects in the country. To suppress these voices of freedom, the Pakistani Army and intelligence agency ISI are now flouting all the limits of human rights by targeting Baloch women and children. On September 21, Taj Bibi was killed allegedly by the Frontier Corps in Turbat. A bullet hit her forehead inside the car she was travelling in before she could even introduce herself at the check post. In October this year, a 10-year-old boy, Ramiz Khalil, was shot dead during a police raid at his home in the early hours while his younger brother got injured. These incidents shocked Balochistan. Baloch activists, student organizations, and human rights groups called the incident inhuman and barbaric, and examples of extreme aggression and hatred against Baloch nation.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Yeshi Chonsom signing off on behalf of the entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.